my victory. When all I see is the mountain, you see a mountain move. And as I walk, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I'm safe. So when I fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high, oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night. Belongs to you. And if you are for me, who can be against me? For Jesus, there's nothing impossible. Shadows, you in every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. An almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you in every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night.
So strange to see everybody here with the lights on. I like to see the Jets jerseys, though. That's pretty awesome. So let's give this service to God this morning, and let's pray against the enemy, because we have had major issues this morning with all sorts of different stuff. So stand with us today as we pray. Father God, I thank you for this day. I thank you for the privilege of standing before you and worshiping this morning. I pray that you would open our hearts for the message you have for us. And I ask that you would just be here this morning. I pray your Holy Spirit would take control of this service. I pray every aspect of this service would have a hedge of protection around it this morning, Lord, that you would be glorified. I thank you. Open our hearts to the message you have for us today. We give you the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you.
You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. 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 That is who you are.
Christ is risen.
Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus
Christ. Bear your cross as you wait for the crown. Tell the world of the treasures you found. Thank you, Lord, for this morning. I pray that you would be lifted up. Thank you so much for being here. Just flow through this building this morning.
Come, let us sing to the Lord. Come, let us bow down.
Jesus here.
let the rock cry out in my place. We return the breath you gave with our praise. Oh, I won't let the rock cry out in my place. We return
remembering you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him, having the eyes of your heart enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints. Father, give us the spirit of wisdom and revelation, the knowledge of who you are. God, let the eyes of our hearts be enlightened to see the hope that which you have called us to. A life of following you, a life worshiping you, and life everlasting. God, give us revelation in our hearts, God, that we would know who you are, that our hearts would be captivated by you. Father, come and fill us with your spirit. Lord, that as we just sang, we would not let the rocks cry out. God, that our mouth would be full of praise for you, that our lives would be full of praise for you. God, help us. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning, church family, and welcome here. If you're visiting with us, we're so glad you joined us this morning. We hope you enjoy our service and our worship time together. Well, it's that time of year. Summer camps are going to be looking for students to work there. So if you are interested in working at a summer camp, did you know that our missions team has a bursary fund for summer camp workers? So if you're a teenager, you don't have a summer job yet, and you'd like to serve at a Christian summer camp, get an application at the church office today and serve in that capacity. All of the Christian camps, Sagamus, Winkler, Red Rock, Rosa River, any that you can think of need help and they need workers. All right, also our women's ministry, Uplift Women's Ministry, has the IF Niverville Gathering Conference coming up on May 3rd and 4th. They've extended the registration date just in case you may have friends or family that want to squeak in. And so stop by the table in the foyer this morning and sign up for IF Gathering Niverville if you haven't already. Thanks again for being here. Have a great week. God bless you, and I'll see you next Sunday. Hey, good morning, church family. I'm coming to you this morning from the beautiful city of Cairo. We are having a phenomenal time here, met with some beautiful, friendly people. Friday is the day of worship here, and so it's Saturday morning right now when I'm filming this. But so we went to three churches yesterday and just had some incredible experiences. I can't wait to share some of them with you, but just one for now. A couple came in and sat in front of us, and we got talking to them, and lo and behold, he lives around the corner from where I lived in Nova Scotia growing up. And so just what are the chances? They were, him and his wife were going through an incredible difficult time right now, and we had the opportunity to just pray with them and share the word of the Lord, and it was just an incredible encounter. And there's been all kinds of things like that, and so I can't wait to be home and go on the men's retreat next week and share stories. And then of course I'll be back with you next Sunday as we I think complete our series on Build My Church as we talk about our citizenship being in heaven. And so I appreciate the continued prayer while we're here, and I look forward to sharing my stories and the things God is doing. He is on the move in the world. Truly the harvest is ripe, but the laborers are few. And so I'm excited about what God is doing and is going to do through us as a church. And so anyway, thanks for your support, and I'll see you soon. God bless.
It never ceases to amaze me how Chris finds people from the East Coast everywhere he goes. The amount of times that he comes into stabbing, oh man, I met somebody from the East Coast. Like, how? You haven't left Manitoba. Well, now he has. The fact that he's gone to Egypt and found someone from the East Coast is amazing. Before I pray, you may not have heard, there's some big congratulations for today. Zach and Tria got engaged last week, so give them a round of applause. It's always exciting to see more people getting engaged. It's always exciting. Let's pray. God, I thank you for this morning. I thank you that you are here, that you are wanting to speak to us, you are wanting to draw us closer to you, that when believers are gathered, when believers are gathered to worship, your spirit is there. God, I ask that you would give me the words to speak today. Would you guide my thoughts? Would you give me a clarity of speech? God, we lift up the offering. We ask that you would bless it for use of the kingdom. God, that the gospel would go forth. In Jesus' name, amen. Few of you have already said this morning, I knew you were preaching because you're wearing a jacket. I was like, yep, that makes sense. And then one of our LT members came up and was like, you know, if you put a little white piece of tape there, it would look like you're a priest. And I was like, that's funny. welcome here this morning. It's not every day that I get to speak, but it is every time that Chris isn't here. I think he doesn't like me preaching. No? Okay, anyway. Our society likes things to be easy. Would you agree? Do you want life to be hard? No. I mean, that's also what my last message was on suffering. Like, it's the flip side, right? Our society, our culture puts tremendous value on making money, trying to be as successful as possible, on gathering wealth, and using that wealth to have comfort. I know, I like comfort. I like a nice couch, a good movie to watch, to have times of just not doing anything. Our culture idolizes the idea of winning the lottery, right? I'm not gonna get you guys to put your hands up on that one. But the idea of winning the lottery, right? Then all of our problems are solved. I don't have to work as hard. I'm not worried about the finances. I'm not stressed about what if another bill comes up? What if? We have this idea that if we have enough, we'll be safe. Many of us desire to have enough just to solve our problems. You know what? If I didn't have to think about this thing, it'd just be so much nicer. Or maybe it's even just inconveniences. Oh man, I wish I had enough money where I could get a bigger house. Especially I want a garage. I want a heated garage. I say that as someone who just bought a house with an attached garage in Niverville. We want these nice little comforts, things that solve our inconveniences. But that's not how church works. That's not how the Christian life works. We're not called just to collect enough money to be in a good place. Church isn't a place where you get to buy your seat. I know Chris has joked many times of how, like, we are very particular about where we sit. And if you've sat there, and if you're new, you might have sat in someone's seat. Don't worry about it. You didn't. It's not. No one's paid for seats. We have this idea that if we give a little bit more money, maybe we get a little bit of extra perks. Or, well, I tithe here, what I say matters. We have this idea, maybe I could be a super tither. You know, you're supposed to give 10%. I gave 15. Maybe I should get a little extra blessing. You know, oh, the Lord sees that I gave a little bit more. I'm going to get a little bit more. This isn't Patreon where you give a little bit, you get a little bit. This is church. Church is not a product to be consumed. You don't get to show up on Sunday or Saturday or Wednesday or Friday, whatever day it is. You don't get to show up and consume something that you desire. This isn't like a sporting event where you pay your ticket, maybe you show up, you get some concessions, you sit down, enjoy the show. You know, maybe you, as soon as the game's done or as soon as the movie's over, you are booking it out there. I'm done. I'm getting out of here. You know, I got to beat the traffic. Church isn't like that. Although, I confess, I've thought that way many times. I've thought, oh, you know what? I don't know if I really like that today. Or, oh, man, that message wasn't for me. Or various things along the lines of, I went to church as a consumer. I paid my ticket. I didn't get what I got. Many of us, whether we consciously think of it or not, we have a criteria for which we judge our church services by. Right? We want a good message. Within good message, you know, can't be too long. It's got to be, fairly, it's got to be biblically focused. It's got to be relevant to my life. I want a good message. We want worship that is pleasing to the ear, right? How many of us are like, oh, there was this thing that sounded bad, or, oh, they made a mistake, or whatever. I will say, we are blessed at this church with our worship teams. We have phenomenal musicians and singers. But it's still one of the things like, oh, yeah, I don't know about worship today. Or various things, or maybe I didn't, you know what, I wish they did this song. Why do they always do this one? We all have these little criterias, whether we think about it a lot or not, of what we judge a church service by. I'm not perfect on this. This is something I have very much struggled with. I can't count the amount of times that I've left a church service and being like, yeah, I didn't really enjoy worship today. And Francis Chan has a great response to that. And I've heard it many years ago, and it's always resonated and stuck with me. And his response to that is, that's okay. We weren't worshiping you. I'll be honest, that one's convicting. The idea that whether you like something or not is based on us. Our worship isn't about us. On the lines of we can't be consumers. We can't buy our way into church. In Acts 8, 18 to 20, I don't have the slide for this. I'm not going to read it. But it's in this passage. There's Simon, who's the apostles have gone around. There's healings and signs and wonders in the city he lives in. Simon is someone who's always had influence, right? And he sees the miracles, and he goes up to them and be like, hey, how much can I pay you for your blessing? Like your anointing, the things you can do, can I pay you? Like I got money, right? I've been successful. Can I buy what you have? And in this, the apostles rebuke him, and the shame of you can't, right? The idea that we can't buy more of the Holy Spirit. We can't buy more of God's love. We can't buy favor. We can't buy things of the Spirit. I know personally, I want the easy way. When it comes to my faith, it would be so nice if I could just pay the money, go to a conference, listen to some good messages, and like leave just on fire for the Lord, life changed, done. And that happens. It does. But the anointing, the favor, the blessing of the Lord that sticks with you is not one that just comes from a weekend conference. It comes from a life devoted to God. The apostles didn't show up one day and just get something, right? They followed Jesus for 3 years. They served and continued to serve. We want the easy way. I want the easy way. I shouldn't speak for all of you. The easy way would be so nice. It'd be so much easier. But the thing is the church isn't, as I said, isn't a place to consume something. Rather, we are the church. As a community of believers, we are the church. As a community of believers who gather here on Sunday mornings, this is a church. One of the underlying themes of this series that Chris has been going through is how we have been transformed into the temple of the Holy Spirit. How in the Old Testament, there was a physical building that the Shekinah glory or the God's Spirit resided. But how after the cross, the veil was torn and that the Holy Spirit was released to be inside of us, for us to be transformed into the temple. So that when we gather together, we are the church. We can't consume what isn't consumable. And while we do build physical building, this building costs money to build. It does. That's not what building the church looks like. Building the church doesn't look like paying enough money. Rather, building the church looks like believers coming together and serving God. The believers coming together and serving one another. Because as Christians, we are called to serve. We are not called to just sit in pews or sit in chairs on a Sunday morning or just, you know what, we have our chair at home where we do our devos. We're not just called to do that. We are called to serve. In the Old Testament, the Levites were the tribe that was set apart. And within the tribe of Levi, there was Aaron and then his lineage, which were the priests. But the entire tribe of Levi were set apart from the beginning to serve in and around the temple. Even when Israel was wandering through the wilderness, the tribe of Levi were set apart. They were holy. They were ones who were living the right way, and they actually camped surrounding the tabernacle so that like the rest of the people didn't die. They were ones that were set apart. But they weren't all priests, yet they all served the Lord. And with us being the temple, we are all called to be like the Levites who served the Lord. Jesus calls his disciples together and says that they should strive to be servants to all rather than trying to be rulers over anyone. Mark 10, 42 through 45. Yes. Jesus called them to him and he said to them, "You know that those who are considered rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. But it shall not be so among you. But whoever would be great among you must be your servant. And whoever would be first among you must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." Jesus serves. In every area of his life, when he was here on earth, and even now, he still serves as our high priest. So if Jesus, the one that we follow, the one that we desire to be transformed into the image of, the one that we worship, if he serves, then shouldn't we? Shouldn't we also serve like Jesus does? Like Jesus does, we are called to serve the world, serve in the world. As Christians, we have all encountered the Holy Spirit. We've all encountered God's love, his kindness, his mercy, and his grace, his tenderness. That love, his mercy, and his grace, that tenderness that he has shown us should be inside of our hearts. It should be inside of the way we interact with people. It should be on display as we interact with the world the way God has called us to interact with the world. Put up Matthew 25. For I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came to me. Then the righteous will answer him saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? And when did we see you a stranger and welcome you, or naked and clothe you? And when did we see you sick or in prison and visit you? And the king will answer them, truly I say to you, as you did it to one of the least of these, my brothers, you did it to me. As we do this to strangers, as we do this for the least of these, the ones that society looks down on, we are serving Jesus. Which means as we are out about in our lives, maybe you get up to a red light and there's someone who's asking for money. When you give that person money, you're not just helping them, you're actually serving Jesus. Jesus also says in this conversation, like right before this, in this story, this parable, it says he's dividing the people between his right and his left side. And the right side are those who have served him. And on the left side, it says it's those who haven't served him. It's those who didn't serve the stranger, didn't help those who were naked and poor, hungry, didn't visit those who were downtrodden. Didn't visit and help those that the world looked down upon. And it says those people, the ones who did not serve the Lord, even though they may say they did, they were put on the left side, and the king says to them, depart from me. Now we as a congregation, we actually have a number of ways that we are serving the Lord in this capacity, that we are going out and helping those who are considered less than, those who are struggling, those who society has overlooked, right? As a church, we help with helping hands here in town. We have a food drive coming up in May where we will gather what extra we have to help those who don't have enough. We just had a missions trip where a group of 20 or so went to Ensenada, who built a house for someone, for a lady and a family who did not have a house. For a number of years, Art and Chair Sawatsky have been doing something called Feed My Lambs, where once a month, them and a few others, I believe Ryan and Christian help, they go into inner city Winnipeg and they feed the hungry. Our youth has been attempting to serve in the community, attempting to live out our faith in a tangible way. And it's something that I want to continue to grow within our youth group. By serving the Lord, by showing mercy, love, and kindness, it's one of the ways that we advance the gospel. It's one of the ways that we open the doors for the truth of Jesus to be proclaimed. To paraphrase Teddy Roosevelt, people don't usually care about what you have to say until they know that you care. It's a lot easier just to go, go walk around a mall. Hey, have you heard about Jesus? Hey, have you heard about Jesus? I say quotation marks because it's actually very difficult. But it is a lot harder to serve, to hand out food, to meet people where they are, to love them where they are, build a relationship with them, and then say, hey, have you heard about Jesus? It takes them knowing and seeing the love, kindness, and mercy of Jesus in our own lives for them to receive it. But we aren't just called to serve in the world. We aren't just called to go out to help those who are looked down upon. We are called to serve each other. As Christians, we should eagerly desire to serve one another. John 13, 12 through 15 says this. When he had washed their feet and put on his outer garment and resumed his place, he said to them, do you understand what I have done for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for so I am. If then I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that you also should do just as I have done to you. We know the story. This is right before the crucifixion. This is right before his betrayal. This is the Easter, part of the Easter story, right? Jesus, in the hours before he is betrayed and abandoned by all of his disciples, is saying, I'm washing your feet. This was a job for the servants. This was a job for the lowest people in their society. It was actually one of the ways that you would show honor to someone who was visiting your house. You would wash their feet. Right? They walked around in sandals all day, dry conditions. Their feet got disgusting. So you washed your feet as a show of inviting someone into your presence, right? We are called to serve like he does. If we have the Holy Spirit inside of us, one of the fruits that should come forth is serving each other. Now I know, it's not one of the fruits of the Spirit. I know there's at least three of you out there who are currently singing through that song. One of the fruits of the Spirit is not service. However, one of the fruits of the Spirit is faithfulness. It takes faithfulness to serve one another the way Jesus serves us. Because it is a lot easier to just say, here's the bucket, wash your own feet. It's really easy to say, oh, someone else will do that. I don't have to worry about it. It takes humility and faithfulness to act like Jesus does and act the way he has called us to. We are meant to use the gifts that God has given us to serve one another. In 1 Peter 4, verses 10 through 11, it says, as each has received a gift, use it to serve one another as good stewards of God's varied grace. Whoever speaks as one who speaks oracles of God, whoever serves as one who serves by the strength that God supplies, in order that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. To him belongs glory and dominion forever. Amen. We should want to use the gifts God has given us. We should want to use the passions God has given us to serve. Are you passionate about music? Are you passionate about singing or tech or coffee? This guy right here, passionate about coffee. We should want to use the gifts and passion God has given us to serve one another. We should want to use what is inside of us, what God has given us, to bless others. When we serve God, we are showing that God is inside us. We are showing that his love lives in our hearts. Because it is not natural human nature to help and serve others with no benefit to yourself. As Jesus says in the Gospels, talking about how the Gentiles love those who love them, but we are called to love those who don't love us. When we serve each other, when we serve outside of the church, it shows that God's love is inside us. But it is also by serving we are actually fulfilling the law that God has given us. In Galatians 5, 13 through 14, it says, for you were called to freedom, brothers. Only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love serve one another. For the whole law is fulfilled in one word. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. We are serving God. We are showing our love for God, and we are worshiping God when we serve one another and when we serve in the world. And we don't serve to earn God's love. We're not doing this as a, I have to do something right, or I've made mistakes, I've got to do the right things. We serve the Lord as a response to what he has given us, as a response to his mercy, as a response to his love, his kindness. We should want to serve him as a way of showing and expressing our faith. My last comment before I close is this. God created us to need rest. I'm aware that this sermon is, hey, maybe there's more we can do. But also, God created the Sabbath. He created a day in the week where he told his people to rest. And in the Old Testament, it actually talks about how it's more than just a day. There is a day, but there's also, you're supposed to have seasons where you take a step back, where you spend time resting, where you spend time focusing on your own relationship with the Lord, focusing on your own health, focusing on your family to a greater degree. This is not a club to beat you over the head with. We are called to serve, but we're also called to rest in the Lord. It is important that we listen to what God calls us to do and not just what we want to do. It is easy to sign up for the easy position, or maybe it's beneficial to sign up for a role or to serve in a way that gets us something that we want. Maybe it's being noticed by someone. Maybe it's it benefits us socially or something like that. It's easy to choose something that has something for us. We are called to serve within the church and outside the church. The Bible calls us to do both. We are, as a family of believers, we are to serve one another. We are to prefer each other over ourselves, to meet people where they're struggling. Now, I'm doing this message in April, not July, so you don't think that I'm just here, hey, you want to volunteer for youth? Or do you want to volunteer for Kid Life? Don't worry, it's coming in a couple months. But I'm not here to say, go volunteer. We have sign-up sheets out there. We don't. We have sign-up sheets, but that's the IF conference. I'm not saying go do stuff right now. I wanted to do this message today because those sheets aren't out there. But this message is meant to be, it's not meant to be self-serving. Rather, I want to lovingly and kindly invite you into service. Serving here within your church community, as well as serving in the world around us. I want to leave you with this question today. The question isn't, should you serve? The question is, where is God calling you to serve? Where is he calling you to invest in this community and in the world that he has placed you in? So let's pray. Jesus, I thank you that you walk with us through every season of our lives and every day you are with us. You are the one who is giving us energy. You are the one who is leading us and guiding us. God, I ask that you would help us. Lord, show us where we can be more involved. Show us where we can live the gospel out in our lives. Holy Spirit, we ask for more. We want you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks for coming this morning. See you next week.
Love endures through generations. never changes, never changes. You heard your children, then you hear your children now. You are the same.